We have a fantastic and fascinating topic to discuss today. Some of you may have heard this, especially those of you who are going to watch it on the internet. Believe it or not, Josephus is one of my most popular lectures. I think I first gave this lecture back in 2013. It's one of the early lectures. And then I gave another version of it here in this room, I think in 2015. And I just keep coming back to Josephus because he's really an evergreen topic, and there's an endless fascination with what he stands for and what he has to say about Jewish history. Josephus really is the first Jewish historian, depending on how you want to define the term historian, but there's no question that when you step outside of Tanakh, when you step outside of rabbinic sources in particular, which are not really intended as historical sources, they're intended as religious documents, he is the first person who's really engaging in any kind of history. And it is fascinating to see that he's really one of the first historians, period. I mean, he's in that same category as the great Greek historians in many ways, although he has never enjoyed the same kind of popularity as Herodotus or many of the other classic Greeks. Nevertheless, he has an extremely important place in world Jewish history as well as Jewish history, and we're going to spend, God willing, the next 50 minutes or so really exploring what he means for the history of the Jews. The basics I'm sure you're all familiar with. He is a complicated character who was originally affiliated with the Jews in their revolt against Rome. He was involved in a suicide pact with his comrades, and at the last minute he decided not to go through with it, and he joined the Roman side instead. And with the Romans, he was alive through the entire destruction of the temple. He made his way to Rome, and then he had a great career as a historian. But it's a complex one, trying to unravel in particular what that means for Jewish history in particular. So that's what we're going to focus on tonight. Fascinating, enduring kind of individual with many more questions that we can possibly answer. But let's do the good and welfare first before we get into the material. So tonight's lecture is graciously sponsored by Christopher and Anne-Marie Bray of Florida. They have long been supporters of this class, and I'm really grateful, and I'm very happy to say that we've raised over $16,000 so far, mainly on the internet from people who just enjoy watching these videos and helping out our students with scholarships. My goal is to raise $100,000, so we've still got a ways to go, but I'm really enjoying the fact that, you know, we can provide a service to the community and the larger global community, and that comes back for our students' benefit. Here is how you benefit the students. We have a new landing page, which is really nice. This is, I made a short version of it, bit.ly/Abramson Jewish History, so it's a little easier to remember than Turo.edu giving Jewish history scholarship. This has an advantage over the CrowdRise site because obviously Turo maintains this and they don't charge a fee in order to give money to the charity. So this is a kind of an advantage there. And this is the very room we're sitting in right now. This is me standing right here wearing the same suit and the same tie, in fact, as in that picture. So the series this semester is going to focus on the Jews of Italy. If you're watching online and you want to follow the series, I strongly recommend you go to my website, henryabramson.com, and just click on the follow button in the lower right, and then you'll be able to receive email updates or Facebook or whatever you enjoy watching these things on. The entire semester of scheduled lectures is posted online. It's going to be hybrid online and in-person lectures. I'm also giving a few more lectures lately in Brooklyn and other locations. So if you're in the neighborhood, please drop by. This is the website address, and you follow on the bottom right screen. Now, the connection with Italy is because, as you know, I've been connected with this amazing organization called Kosher Riverboat Cruises, where we pick different rivers around the world, and we spend a week just exploring Jewish history there. And I'm having an amazing time doing it. The next river we're going to explore is the Po River in northern Italy. We're going in July, God willing, to Venice through Padua, the home of the great Ramchal, the author of the Mesillat Yesharim, and then a little further up towards Milan and so on. So that's the reason why we're going to be spending a lot of the whole semester studying Italy is to prepare for that trip. Next semester will be the south of France. And we get to go out with people like my colleague David Kraus, who's a Prague historian. Here's a photograph of us in the Great Synagogue in Budapest, which is where we visited last time. Okay, I think that's it for Good and Welfare. Let's get straight to the material. So our sources for today are, as always, a mix of primary and secondary sources. Primary sources, for those of you who are less familiar with the historical discipline, are basically those sources which speak to the person or moment itself in a contemporary manner. In other words, in the case of Josephus, we're going to be looking at books written by Josephus about himself and about his life. There are not a lot of primary sources about Josephus written by other people. But if we had such documents, certainly we would look at them. So there are four basic works that Josephus authored that are extremely important. The first is called The Jewish War. This is his first book, and it is a chronicle of the first Roman Jewish War, the Temple Revolt of the late 60s of the Common Era, the first century of the Common Era, which of course results in the disastrous defeat of the Jewish rebels, the destruction of the temple, the exile of the Jews, and so on. It is a compelling and powerful account that is really unparalleled with any other contemporary account. We have another historian who came along a little later than Josephus who wrote something about it, but with the exception of Josephus, there is no one who really tells us firsthand what happened during that revolt. And all later historians have to rely very heavily on Josephus to tell us about that. It's fascinating in many ways because, you know, you think about the nature of Jews today and Jewish news today. I was just talking about it at the Shabbos table with some guests that, you know, Israel is this tiny little postage stamp of a country. It's like a third of the size of Florida. It's probably about the size of Delaware or something. And yet it occupies at least 40% of the newspaper space and, you know, at least 10% of the internet overall. That's an amazing thing. And it begins really right back from the ancient period. The Romans conquered so many territories, and it is amazing that we have a one big massive book that's specifically dedicated to the crushing of this admittedly difficult rebellious province in the Near East, but otherwise we don't have anything comparable to it for any territory its size. So the Jewish War is extremely important. It tells us a lot about his experiences during the war in Galilee and then later afterwards in Rome, and we'll return to it shortly. The second huge book that he wrote, the Jewish War was composed probably within the first five or so years after the war ended. That is probably before the year 75 or so. There are descriptions of how it is placed, for example, in the Temple of Peace that Titus erected in Rome, so that we have some rough idea of when that was dated. He then did not write, or did not publish at least, for 20 years. Publishing, of course, means circulating manuscripts, because this is, you know, 1,500 years before publishing is invented. And they would be circulated, he 20 years later, he wrote this massive book, about eight times the size of Jewish War, called Jewish Antiquities, which is basically a history of the Jewish people, the very first serious history of the Jewish people, going all the way back from Adam and Eve, you know, creation, through the Exodus, bringing you all the way up to the Maccabean era, and of course the Jewish War itself. An incredibly valuable source, because again, we have nothing like it for this period whatsoever. Once again, he relies very heavily on other sources. Josephus is, by contemporary terms, if he handed in a book like this in my class, we would probably give him an F for plagiarism, and then we would probably expel him. But that, we should realize, was not necessarily out of keeping with the historical standards of the day. It was considered appropriate that when you found someone else's book that made a lot of sense, you just copied the whole thing, put it into your book, and put your name on it, and then away you go. Mind you, it sounds a lot like cut and paste from the internet today, so plus plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose. I'll take questions in just a few minutes. So the Jewish Antiquities, this massive book, much larger than Jewish War, written 20 years later, that appears to fill a need, an audience in Rome that is hungry for information on who are these strange Jewish people? Why do they, you know, continuously rebel against us, and what do they stand for? And so Jewish Antiquities gives us this large overview. The next book, which is very short, is his autobiography. It is a little disappointing as an autobiography goes, because it only really deals with 6 months of his life, an important 6 months. It deals with primarily his experience during the war. And in fact, there's a lot of interesting debate among scholars as to exactly why would he write a book on his life and only have like a few paragraphs at the beginning about his childhood till he's about 26, and then have a little bit at the very end after, you know, the rest of his life when he's in Rome. It could be that it was originally written as a short addendum to Jewish Antiquities because it was kind of like an about the author. And since it was a large book to begin with, Jewish Antiquities is in a huge number of volumes, so then he added something which is more or less book length at the end to say, well, this is my story, and the part that you're most interested in, of course, is what happened to me in the Jewish War, so that's where we get most of it. So it's not really a full autobiography by any measure, but nevertheless, it gives us some sense of his life, and it's very valuable, especially when compared to the Jewish War account, and there are some inconsistencies between the two. Finally, the last work, something he wrote in his maturity, and I should give you, by the way, his years. He was born in approximately the year 37, and he died shortly after the year 100. So it's a really important, you know, three quarters of a century there. And one of the last things he wrote at the very end of his life, around the year 100, was something called Contra Appionem, Against Appion, which was essentially an apology for Judaism, meaning he was defending Judaism from an early attack by someone named Appion. Appion's original text is gone. We do not know what he wrote that was so nasty about the Jews, but we do have Josephus's response in which he defends Judaism from a number of charges. So these four books together, which on the Touro library shelf take up about a foot and a half of space, are what we have as primary documents about Josephus's life and worldview, and it's really quite a significant amount of information. Looking at secondary sources, I read fairly widely for tonight's lecture, but I think the most important sources that I've been working with are a series of essays that were published out of a conference that was held at York University in Toronto, Canada. And Flavius Josephus and Flavian Rome is the title of this particular collection, and it is edited by, among other people, Steve Mason, who was one of the great scholars of the Roman Jewish War. We have downstairs in the library a massive tome that, it's roughly the size of a house that is all dedicated to the Jewish War. I've never met him in person, but I was part of a documentary that was filmed about a year ago, and I'm really waiting for it to come out. It was an Australian film company, and it's called The Fatal Conflict, and the subtitle is something like The Conquest of Judea or something, and he was apparently a talking head in it, so it looks like we know each other and we're friendly, but haven't met him yet. Anyways, great stuff. If we look at the life as our starting part, his autobiography, he gives us only two paragraphs of his upbringing and then goes straight into his encounter with Rome. So it's just two short paragraphs. And I have to tell you that looking at it, he's not an especially likable guy. I mean, I had difficulty identifying with Josephus reading his life. He tends to be a bit, I mean, at least by modern standards, he is a braggart. He is incredibly boastful. He is vindictive, and sometimes it's not hard to read between the lines. He sounds like he's cowardly and manipulative, and we wonder about what kind of character it is that's leading us through this story of the period. But nevertheless, this is the only story we have, so we have to work with it. Yes, question?
Yeah, how does that compare to the other
oh my gosh, everybody is so smart here. You guys are. So one of the qualifying, Steve Mason, for example, sort of apologizes for Josephus and says, well, you know, the fact is it's considered perfectly normal for authors to brag about their own accomplishments and to tout their own wares and things like that. I left it in my office. I would have liked to have read some of the passages where he just puts down other historians and he says they don't know what they're talking about. But the thing is, when you're reared on a diet of rabbinic literature, it is so foreign to hear people boasting about themselves. It's true, occasionally you will find these verses that are outliers in Tanakh, but usually they're spoken by the bad guys where they're boastful. You know, like I'm thinking of one pasuk in Mishle, one verse in Proverbs says, Yehalelcha zar velo picha. Let a stranger praise you, not your own mouth. Right? And that's kind of like a basic value, I think, that runs through rabbinic culture. And it does not seem to be apparent whatsoever in Josephus, which is surprising because he says that he was a genius who mastered all of rabbinic law, and by the age of 14, all of the elders of Jerusalem were regularly consulting him on the finer points of Jewish law. Like, that's an example of a boastful claim. It's just hard to imagine that you have this pitzela, 14 years old, and all these gray-bearded rabbis are coming to say, oh, Josephus, Josephus, please tell us. It's hard to imagine. But that's how he describes himself. He describes himself as coming from extremely noble lineage, actually from royal lineage, Chashmonaim lineage on his mother's side. And he's a priest, which is problematic because he has a rather kind of messed up family life, some aspects of which might be incompatible with his Kohen status. He was married, for example, three times. The first time he was apparently given a wife by the Emperor Vespasian in Alexandria, which is the problem because a Kohen could not marry a captive woman, a woman who had been taken captive. But it didn't really matter because she abandoned him. She left him. He married another woman, and then, as he says at the end of his life, but then she displeased me, so I got rid of her, and he married a third woman, and we don't know of any subsequent wives, but at least three marriages. That never happens with like political leaders nowadays. We never see that kind of thing. Thank you for the recognition of that offhanded comment. No, he just divorced her. He divorced her. I don't think he had the gumption to kill anyone. But he describes he has a certain number of sons. He describes them very briefly. But that's all we really know about his family. Well, this is before we had any of those sub-ethnic groups. I mean, he was a Kohen, so he was like of standard lineage. He was not an Idumean or anything like that. He was your regular average Jew. He liked egg rolls, you know, pastrami, things like that. But he describes his youth. So by 14, he had mastered all rabbinic law, and he was, you know, consulted by the rabbis. And then he decided he wanted to know everything about all the other sects that were active in Israel. So he actually went through a period of even living with the Essenes for 3 years, living on nuts and berries and studying their aesthetic and their ascetic ways, their, you know, separation from life and so on. And then by the time he was 19, he considers to have completed his universal education, and he's a master of all traditions in Judaism at that point. As I mentioned, it's hard to really like him if that's the way he begins, with such an exaggerated depiction of himself. So the exaggeration is there, the falsification, things like that. But then almost immediately after he goes through just three paragraphs in the beginning of the book, then he describes how at 26, he is sent on a mission to Rome to rescue some Kohanim, apparently priests, could be rabbis, but probably priests, who have been captured by the Romans, are being held perhaps under some kind of criminal charges. It's not at all clear. Now, this is something for which we have corroboration in rabbinic texts. There were significant numbers of rabbis who were making the journey to Rome to appeal to the governing authorities for one thing or another. And it appears that he was one of the tag-alongs on one of these ventures to Rome. His description of it gives you the idea of a wide-eyed youth who was just overwhelmed with the grandeur of Rome. And let us recall that Rome really was an amazing place in the first century. I mean, the architecture, the discovery of building techniques, the institutions, the plumbing. I mean, there are incredible amounts of advances, technological advances. It would be like someone coming from Outer Mongolia and visiting Seoul, South Korea, with, you know, wide broadband internet everywhere and things like that. It was like a huge leap forward from the provincial city of Jerusalem to this, you know, Manhattan of the ancient world, and getting the tremendous number of people there, the tremendous amount of society and culture and so on. And he was really quite overwhelmed. He describes how close he got to many of the ruling figures, Nero's own wife, for example, in traditional self-serving terms. And then the mission ends successfully. He returns back to Israel. And he finds Israel in revolt. And this is the period that has received so much attention, because when he gets back to Israel about the year 66, perhaps 67, Israel is openly rebelling against Rome. Where I've talked about this significantly in the last time I spoke about Josephus, so I don't want to go into too much detail, but basically let's focus on a couple of aspects that he highlights in his autobiography. He is mysteriously given command of the Galilee region. Very important post, northern Israel. There's a lot of military activity there. But we don't know exactly why. Like, he does not really present to us the reasoning behind this. And furthermore, from the get-go, he is not a believer in the revolt. He thinks that the Jews should immediately beg for forgiveness from the Romans, put down their arms, and, you know, go along, that the Romans have such vastly superior might, it's just going to result in tremendous bloodshed. The Romans have a superior governing culture, and they're very fair, and they're very legal, and they're very, you know, everything is great, we should go along with the Romans. So this is one of the big questions that we had earlier. Can we trust Josephus's account? And there are a couple reasons why it's problematic. We know, for example, well, actually, let me start with this. He wrote this as a Roman captive, right? He wrote this after he had surrendered to Vespasian and then his son Titus, and he was entirely at their command. He was directly under their supervision for 2 years in Israel and in Egypt, and he did not have the freedom of movement. It was only after some time that he was actually allowed to have some kind of commerce with regular society outside of his captivity. So it's not hard to imagine that the words that he is going to write are going to be portraying the Romans in an ingratiating fashion, because he knows the Romans are going to read this. This is written, by the way, in Greek, not in Latin. That was his second, possibly his third language, but the Greek was the language of the Eastern world. It was the lingua franca of that time of the Roman East. Of course, it would continue to be so for quite some time under Byzantium, but the Romans preferred Latin. And literate people were comfortable with both languages at this time. We know that he wrote a version of this book first in Aramaic. That version has been lost. So scholars opine, what exactly was the point of having him write it in Aramaic, which was, by the way, the first language of the Jews? Hebrew was still, although it was widely spoken, it was still the language of high culture, and it was the language of religion and language of liturgy, but the language of the street was Aramaic. And most scholars seem to feel that he was asked to write this in Aramaic as a warning to the peoples of the East not to rebel against the Romans. And writing in a language that they did not have the same facility with, he may have expressed things in very different ways, but he still would have given the same message that we should not be rebelling against the Romans. The Parthian threat in particular was very important to the Romans, and they probably used Josephus to try and quell any incipient rebellions coming from the East, so they used him as kind of a propaganda mouthpiece to do so. After this Aramaic version, which was was probably successful after it had significant circulation, the suggestion was made, we don't know where it came from, to perhaps write this in Greek as, if nothing else, a testimony to the victory of the Romans. They were very, very proud of this particular victory because they had invested a ridiculous amount of troops. By the way, it took 7 times more troops to conquer Israel than it did to conquer England. And it was an incredible investment of military might. The Jews just would not give up. And the number of commemorative coins that the Romans put out that said Judea Capta, Judea is captured, Judea is destroyed, it just dwarfed the number they put out for much larger territories because it was really an irritating thing for them that they had to fight so long to hold this little piece of territory, the only country in the Middle East with no natural reserves of oil or gas. So we don't know. They have gas now? They, oh, so they have gas. Okay, so that they didn't know that then, though. I didn't know that until a minute ago. So he was given an important military command in the Galilee, but according to his own description, he didn't want it. He didn't believe that they should be fighting against the Romans. And whenever he had the opportunity, he's really trying to like suggest that maybe we shouldn't be fighting, don't start up, which reminds me of a joke. I know I'm trying not to tell too many jokes in this particular class because especially people on the internet don't like it. But the joke goes like this. I know, what? But what are you going to do? the joke goes, 2 Jews are being led out for execution. They're being taken out to the firing squad. And one of them starts saying, it's a mistake. I'm innocent. Don't shoot me. You got the wrong guy. And the other one says to him, shah, don't make trouble. Right. So he's constantly involved with all kinds of intrigues with Tiberian Jews in particular, who are much more bellicose, and he's always trying to suggest they don't fight. And there's so much intrigue; it's dizzying to hear how he is constantly working among factions, trying to like benefit himself. And again, it's very self-serving accounts. He talks about how he's so magnanimous and generous in spirit, and then they stab him in the back. And we won't go into details in those things. The text is apologetically pro-Roman, as I've mentioned, probably for those reasons. He's a captive. He is also kind of like in this liminal state between being professionally Jewish in a Roman environment, right? He is the number one professional Jew. He is the appointed representative of the Jewish people in Roman culture and society. And whatever he says is going to be understood as what Jews say and believe. He may not have wanted this role so much, but he found it impossible to leave it. And so what he says in the Jewish war is a reflection of his status as that kind of professional Jew. Now, what ends up happening is there's a siege, and it's pretty clear that the Jews are going to lose out, and so they adopt a suicide pact, which Max has already shared with me. It's the Josephus paradox. It's actually a math problem based on Josephus' name. I just learned this morning. It's fascinating. Basically, what they do is they draw straws to see who will be the last one alive to make sure that everyone commits suicide, and then that last person will kill. Or I think maybe they'll have pick one guy to kill the others, and then he'll kill himself. I can't remember exactly how it went. But at any rate, amazingly, he says by the grace of God, somehow, even though he agreed to commit suicide with all the others, he ends up being the last guy holding the straw. And he says, it must be that God wanted me to live, because he gave me the last straw, which is just ridiculous, right? That was the whole point of the exercise, is that someone would be picked to be the last person. So he ends up surrendering to the emperor. Well, he's not the emperor. He ends up surrendering to the general Vespasian, and he goes out there, and he greets him like an emperor. And Vespasian says, why are you greeting me like an emperor? I'm just a general. He says, no, but you will one day be declared emperor. Sure enough, he is then declared as emperor. Vespasian is so grateful, and he heard that this Jew sort of prophesied that certainly stood him in good stead. Vespasian then goes back to Rome to take care of his emperor-type duties, and he leaves Titus, his son, in charge of the rest of the attack on Jerusalem, together with Josephus. Ultimately, after a certain amount of time, Josephus becomes a favorite of the family. He is manumitted, he is freed, and he is given the name Flavius, which is the family name of Vespasian and Titus. And he's kind of like their adopted Jew. It is ironic. I'm sure you're familiar of the story of Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, which is told in the Talmud that he had exactly the same story happen to him and Vespasian. So I can leave it to you to tease out who's plagiarizing from who, but it's an identical story. That's how he ends up becoming a Roman and how he is taken back to Rome. I talked already about the two versions of the Jewish war, right? And the price, I've already talked about this stuff here. Now, 20 years later, maybe I can pause for a question, if anyone. So trying to understand the trajectory of his activity, imagine he's come back from Judea. He has written first an Aramaic account and then a very popular Greek account of the war, and he has received tremendous honors as a result. As I mentioned, Titus puts up this big temple of peace that commemorates all of the various victories of the Romans. It's an ironic term, a temple of peace, but really what it means is a temple of Roman domination. And in that temple of peace, they put all kinds of treasures from the various peoples that they have conquered, apparently including the menorah and the shulchan and other accoutrements from the temple. There's an interesting debate about what exactly happened to the menorah. But and they put in there also this account of the battle written by Josephus. Yes, question.
Aside from writing this history,
yes.
Did he do anything to help his
people? Well, that's a good question. I'll repeat it. Besides from writing this history, did he do anything to help his people? I would say yes, but you're going to have to be patient because I got to explain a little bit more about what else he wrote. So the 20 years later, we'll start with this. 20 years later, he comes up with a massive book, The Jewish Antiquities. And this is an extremely important work because for the first time, we have a Jew acting as a culture broker, offering to the larger world a positive depiction of Judaism. It's far broader than the very narrow Jewish war, which was designed primarily to lionize Titus and Vespasian. The Jewish Antiquities is a glimpse into the ancient culture that is, you know, like it's one of those turning point books in Roman history. It's kind of like, I don't know, those of you who went to high school in the 1970s, it's like that book, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. Like everybody read it, and maybe I'm the only guy who went to high school in the 1970s, I guess. But that was like one of those turning point books that everybody was talking about it. Or like, what's a turning point book nowadays? The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, right? Everybody talks about that in productivity. Blank stares. Okay, let's go on. I'm going to cut that out. Jewish Antiquities, the title Antiquity is highly important because one of the things that the ancient world loved was old things. And not so much like whether something was logically consistent or whether it was practical or whether it was beautiful, but if it was old, it automatically had heft. It automatically had gravitas. It was something extremely valuable. And if anything, the Jews could say, hey, we are really old. Our civilization goes way back further than Roman civilization. It goes back further than Etruscan civilization. It goes back further even than Egyptian civilization. And when he put this book together and demonstrated just how old the Jews were as a people, that was a massive statement of the power of Judaism in the Roman world. There's a lot of debate among scholars as to how popular Judaism was. Some scholars have estimated that as many as 10% of Roman citizens were converts to Judaism. Now, that's probably an exaggerated figure, but there's no question that Judaism, largely as a result of the efforts of people like Josephus, was a very competitive ideology in the ancient world. That it was compelling, it had a message, it had a trajectory, it had all kinds of things that Roman society, Roman ideals did not have, and it really put Judaism on the map. So Jewish antiquity is a hugely important work. That's part of the reason why he attracted so much venom from people like Appian, because people wanted to say, no, it's not like that. It's not, you guys aren't quite so powerful as you are. One of the characters that he had to discuss the antiquity of the Jews with, for example, was the Egyptian writer Manetho, who rewrote the Exodus story and said that the Jews did not, they were not liberated from Egypt by God. We kicked them out because they were lepers. You know, it totally changes the story. And Josephus gets right in there and says, that's a ridiculous version of events. You know, I can tell you exactly what it says in Exodus. You can check it out for yourself. Go into any shul and so on. So Jewish Antiquities was a massive work that really put Josephus on the map far more than his first book, because it really was the, if you'll forgive the term, the Bible of Judaism for non-Jews. It was accessible in Greek, and it was a huge success, very widely repeated. Now, he was not so much he was not really a creative historian. He was regularly borrowing, and we can put that term in quotation marks, he was regularly borrowing from lots of other historians that came before him. Most of those historians, like Appian, for example, he argues with Appian, so we lose Appian, even though we have his argument against them. Most of those historians are lost because in the ancient world, particularly with the nature of valuable manuscripts and so on, it was considered much more amenable to save the effective abridged notes than to save the originals. So, for example, if you had one author who told a long-winded story, and you had another author who took that long-winded story and encapsulated it into a much shorter version, the old version just was tossed away, and we kept the smaller version, which is a huge shame for, you know, our study of the classical world, because we don't know what they actually said themselves. We only have the briefs. In fact, a term I just learned from Steve Mason's book, to epitomize, right? We say that something, he is the epitome of charm, right? So I'm not positive, but if I remember correctly, the term tom is like a piece, like atom means it cannot be cut further, right? Atom, like the atom bomb, an atom cannot be cut further. So epitom, I think, means to take a piece of something. So if you have a long book, and they call these short versions epitomes. These short versions are like, you know, little Cliff's Notes versions of the original, and you lose the original. It reminds me of a frontispiece, a title page I once saw of a Yiddish translation of Shakespeare that said, you know, William Shakespeare verteidigt und verbessert. Right? William Shakespeare translated and improved, right? Like, make it smaller so it makes it improve. So a lot of what Josephus does for us is that he preserves a lot of material in the ancient world that he openly plagiarized from. Unfortunately, we don't have the originals anymore. All we have are Josephus's treatises of them. But again, it's a very fortunate thing for us that we have Josephus. It could be that he would have been plagiarized by another writer, and then we lose them altogether. Yes, question.
What was Josephus's audience? Were the Romans, or were the Israelis, or whatever?
His excellent question. His audience is overwhelmingly Roman. He's living in Rome. There is a sizable Jewish population there, primarily made up of the slaves that were taken in the war when Jerusalem fell. But he's writing primarily for a Greek-reading, educated Roman audience.
So basically, he's trying to say, this is such great people, and we think that. So really glorified.
It glorifies Rome by extension. Yeah, how much more so is Rome? Yeah, we beat them. It's a good point. Excellent. Now, here's a fascinating part of the Josephus story. Another reason why he may have survived is something called the Testimonium Flavium, and it has to do with Christianity. Again, we're talking about the first century, right? This is the period of Jesus. Jesus, you know, lived and walked in Israel and got his Chinese food regularly in Jerusalem, so we know whatever Josephus must have written about him, right? So there's this passage, which is so famous, it's in the Antiquities, that it's referred to as the Testimonium Flavium, the Josephine testimony. This is what it says. Now there was about this time Jesus, a wise man, if it be lawful to call him a man, right? Wow. If you're a Christian reading this, you're saying, what is this? For he was a doer of wonderful works, a teacher of such men as received the truth with pleasure. He drew over to him both many of the Jews and many of the Gentiles. So far true. He was the Christ. Now, the term Christ in Greek, Christos, means anointed one, which in Hebrew is Mashiach, the Messiah. He was the Messiah, capital M, Messiah. So this statement here, if you're a Christian reading Josephus, it's like a bombshell. It's like, wow, there it is, independent, verifiable, you know, impartial discussion of Jesus being a real live, not a human being maybe, but something really active. The problem is, we don't know if Josephus actually wrote this passage, first of all. It's most likely the addition of an overly enthusiastic monastic copyist, maybe in the third century, who said, you know, Josephus is living in the first century. He's got to say something about Jesus. I'll just stick something in right here. And then it was copied over and over again, and everyone accepted it as a truth. There are a lot of reasons why we could say that. Eusebius quotes it, right, in the third century. So it's also possible, I mean, just think about it for a second. When Josephus uses the word Mashiach, that's like game over, end of time. That's like resuscitation of the dead. The world ends as we know it, and we go into a brand new period of history, unlike anything that we had before. And for him to just go on and write another few volumes with only this one passage about this earth-shattering event is just beyond belief. I mean, it's as if I were to be talking to you right now and say, by the way, let's finish this lecture, but I just heard on CNN that Martians have landed, and they have announced that, you know, the entire government is actually Martians, and they decided to take over our planet, but we still have 20 minutes left. So that could be true, you're right, but we still have 20 minutes left, so let's finish the lecture, right? It doesn't make sense. If I give you a piece of news, like we have found intelligent life and they're here on our planet, that would be the end of the story. So it's really hard to take it at face value. Nevertheless, the rest of the story says, and when Pilate said blah, 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 and the tribe of Christians, the very end, so named from him, are not extinct at this day. That's basically all he has to say about Christianity, by the way. But this is probably somewhere around the year 95 that he's writing. So some of this could actually be Josephus's own words. It's not impossible. It could be that he's saying he was the Christ in the sense that people called him the Christ. It's not precise, although the Greek seems to be fairly straightforward. So what exactly does this passage mean? Scholars have debated it significantly. Is it, first of all, authentic, or is it a later Christian interpolation, such as by the church historian Eusebius or so on? If it is Josephus, did he just sloppily throw this thing in there because he's trying to throw everything in from the first century? And you know, it is 60 years afterwards. Christianity is growing significantly. There are Christians in Rome. There was significant anti-Christian persecution, not so much when this was written, but a little bit earlier under Nero. There was a very strong period of Christian persecution. You know, as the Christian movement is growing, it's also distinguishing itself from the Jewish movement, the Jewish people. When it first started, of course, Christianity was overwhelmingly Jewish. Jesus and all of the apostles were Jewish. Most of the people they talked to were Jewish. But within the decades after the Passion, then it slowly became a non-Jewish religion, appealing primarily to Gentiles who were very entranced with particular St. Paul's description of life after death and a divine personal God and so on, but they were not so crazy about things like circumcision and dietary rules and things like that. Another fascinating aspect of this, like, why are the Jews and Christians really separating at this point? Because again, the early Jews and Christians were still davening at the same shul. It was not quite a breakaway minion at that early point. It may actually come down to the Abramson rule of history, that when you don't know why something happens, it's probably about money. It might have to do with this emperor, Domitian, who ruled from 81 to 96. And among the things that he did, there were two specific things that may have affected Christians differently. And I'm going to lay it out for you, but there is significant scholarly debate right now about this. First of all, the fiscus Judaicus, the Jewish tax, was something that was imposed upon the Jews by Titus. This was essentially the Romans taking over the machatzisa shekel, the half shekel tax that Jews used to pay every year for the upkeep of the temple. As a punishment for the rebellion, Titus said that the machatzisa shekel would now be the fiscus Judaicus. It would be a Jewish tax that would go, and this was a grave insult to the Jews, to the upkeep of the temple of Jupiter in Rome. Instead of that half shekel going to the temple in Jerusalem, to the Jewish god, it would go to the Roman god instead. Now, Titus was not consistent in enforcing the fiscus Judaicus, but Domitian was. And so the Jews were very resentful under Domitian of having to provide this tax for idolatrous purposes. And the Christians were saying, hey, wait a second, we're not Jewish. Don't confuse us with those Jewish guys over there. We are separate. We're Christians, even though we're ethnically Jewish, we speak the same languages. It's not clear to us whether we should be keeping kosher, not be keeping kosher, things like that. But we're not the same as them. And therefore, if we're not the same as them, we should not have to pay the same tax. And so the Christians may have been had some impetus to further the separation from the Jewish movement because they would have exempt themselves from the tax. Furthermore, there was a big question over whether or not the Christians should have to worship at the feet of the statues of the various Caesars. In fact, let me just skip over that right now because that's a little bit more complicated than I have time for. Let's look at one more detail that affected Josephus in particular. Shortly after the war was over, moving to Rome, they, as I mentioned, the Romans made a huge hoo-ha over the victory in Judea, and they erected the Arch of Titus. They actually erected two arches. These are ceremonial arches. Here's a picture of the one that survives, in which you would march all the captives through it in a big parade, and at the very end of it, you would actually put one of the rebels to death, which is in fact what they did. They executed, I think his name was Simon ben Gioria, at the end of this as a symbolic representation of the final defeat of the Jews. The first actual arch was destroyed, has not survived. This one was created a little bit later, and we have a significant things to say about it. First of all, have a look at the top part here. Where's my image? Here it is. This is on the inside of the, this is a bas-relief on the inside of the right of it. Let's just look over here. It occurs right over here in the arch, and it depicts something that Josephus himself must have seen as it was coming into Rome, the Roman soldiers carrying all of the spoils from the temple. I'll show you another version of that in a second. At the top of it, this is something that would have been very galling to Jews and to Christians. It refers to the Divo Tito, Divo Vespasian, which means the newly deified, the new god Titus and the new god Vespasian. The emperors were actually deified at this period, and they were considered literally gods. So this is an extremely offensive thing for Jews to have to encounter and to walk under, and as slaves, prisoners of war, it's just one more thing that they had to tolerate. Now, my colleague at Yeshiva University, Stephen Fine, who was a great scholar, who knows so much more about Josephus than I do, oh my gosh, I'm kind of embarrassed. I hope he doesn't watch this part of the lecture, because, anyways, he did some amazing work. Here he is actually at the Arch of Titus. He did some work chemically and analyzing the actual materials, and he proved that the Arch of Titus was actually painted. The original had these really garish cartoon-like colors, and that the bas-relief actually looks like this. This is what the Romans would have seen in the day, which is kind of bizarre. It looks very cartoonish to me, but let's have a look at it. Here, now my Latin is not that great, but I think this says leges judaeorum, the laws of the Jews, and that's kind of like a sign, I guess, sort of symbolically saying that he took over the Jewish law. And there's the menorah, and this is candelabrum judaeorum, the candelabra of the Jews. And on the right it says sacra judaeorum, the holy thing of the Jews, which is probably the shulchan shown over there. I have to tell you, when I first saw these things, these little signs, I didn't realize they were signs. And one of my students said that he thought they were old TV cameras, you know, they kind of look like they were videoing the thing, like CNN was there. So anyways, that's what he would have seen in his day, and it must have put him in a strange kind of frame of mind, as he has obviously a kinship with these thousands upon thousands of slaves who are taken as a result of the failed rebellion. He himself is free, living as a nobleman, a celebrated nobleman, as you know, someone who is well regarded as an author and moving in literate circles and so on. But nevertheless, that was the difficult life of Josephus. He comes to the last period of his life, and that's when he is attacked by Appian. I mentioned this, and I have the screenshot here from the lecture that I gave on this, so we only have a couple of minutes to look at it, but I would encourage you, if you're interested, to go back online, and you can see a lot more discussion of what he had to say. But Appian took exception with what he felt, and we're reading this, by the way, from Josephus's response to Appian. He took exception with Josephus's sort of self-righteous view of Jewish value, which is ironically a trope that anti-Semitic historians have used since time immemorial. One must think of the great German historian Heinrich von Treitschke in the late 19th century, who really began a whole cycle of very nasty anti-Semitic attacks on Jews, and he even coined a slogan that the Nazis later picked up. To just step for a minute into the 1870s in what they call the Historikerstreich, the historians' debate, there was a great Jewish historian, one of the first encyclopedic Jewish historians, named Heinrich Gretz. He was a student of, among others, the great Samson Raphael Hirsch, and he was a brilliant writer, and he put together this massive history of the Jews in German, which was an amazingly popular book. This is at the end of the 19th century. And his take on Jewish history was basically that, you know, Jews were always unjustly accused of crimes and were suffering, but whenever you give us half the chance, we contribute far beyond our numbers to society. In other words, he was telling the truth, right? But his version of history, which Saro Baron really later called the lachrymose version of history, that it's so sad, these Jews are so misunderstood, they're so persecuted, but when you give them a chance, they're so heroic and they're so intelligent and things like that. The German historian Heinrich von Treitschke was so upset with this depiction, this positive depiction of Jews, that he wrote a nasty amount of articles in the popular press criticizing Gretz for poor history, and in fact saying, like, if you don't like Germany, why don't you just go home, wherever that is. Really nasty comments. And his slogan was, Die Juden sind unser Unglück. The Jews are our misfortune. Like, if only the Jews had not come to Germany, everything would be fine. And if you look at pictures of Nazi rallies, they almost always have that quote up in a big banner, the Jews are our misfortune. So it's almost identical to what Appian must have said to Josephus, saying, you Jews, you have so many awful characteristics, like you're clannish, you refuse to eat with the rest of us because you insist on that ridiculous special diet, and you're misanthropic, you mutilate babies with circumcision at 8 days of age, you're lazy, you take off 1 day in seven, you refuse to work 1 day in seven, that's ridiculous, all kinds of things like this. And so with a very firm voice, Josephus actually rises to his full literary height, and he defends Judaism from a whole host of charges, both the invented charges and some that are simply misinterpretations of actual Jewish practice. And in many ways, I like to think that with against Appian, Josephus kind of reclaims his Jewish identity in a positive way. You know, as a young man being forced into Roman servitude and forced to be in a servile manner and obsequious towards his captors, it's difficult for him to really speak his mind. And then with Jewish antiquities, he is able to describe Judaism in a positive manner, albeit to a Roman audience. But finally, with against Appian, then you really begin to see a little bit of his own tristesse when he reflects back on the course of his life. Even though he has been treated to tremendous honors and riches as a member of the Flavian dynasty by extension, nevertheless, he has a tremendous amount of sympathy for his hapless people who are now suffering and in fact would endure a terrible rebellion only 30 years later in the context of the Bar Kokhba revolt. And so I think in many ways Josephus redeems himself with his work against Appian and really provides the impetus to a Jewish defense against anti-Semitism even in this early period. So to sum up and to try to think about Josephus, he's a kind of a chameleon-like character. He's, in his youth in particular, rather unlikable as a writer, seems boastful, seems prone to self-aggrandizement, but nevertheless provides us with very valuable historical information about how the war unfolded. We get a sense of him being an obsequious sycophant of the Romans for his early career, but then in his old age, through the antiquities, and especially against Appian, he ultimately redeems himself. This is a bust that is traditionally understood to be Josephus, but it is most probably not at all. It's a bust of an unknown figure, but I'm sorry, I didn't bring you the profile of it. He has a very large nose. And so apparently in the Middle Ages, someone decided to say, well, this must be Josephus, because look at that schnoz. And so ironically, this unknown young man has taken on these anti-Semitic calumny as an identification with Josephus, and in many circles it has stuck to the present day. I'm grateful, by the way, to Stephen Fine for correcting me, because I was going to say outright that this is in fact Josephus, which I think would be fantastic, but he corrected me. It apparently is just some Roman guy. Anyways, that is my quick overview of the life of Josephus. I will take a few questions at the end, but for those of you who wish to be dismissed, I want to also mention that next week we'll be jumping ahead about 900 years. We're going to be looking at an amazing text, the first dictionary of Talmud written in Rome by the Aruch, as we'll see, and I hope to say a lot about the Jewish community in Rome at the turn of the millennium. Thank you very much for your attention and your endurance.